want responsible studies to be done. All diagrams and rules should respect the existing zones and the height. For example,
okay, so there's a couple of things. One, publicly I can type, and two, publicly people can listen so they actually get what you're talking about. So one, you have a concern with infrastructure and that make sure that traffic studies and stormwater and other things.
Infrastructure, traffic.
And maybe that was right in front of your mouth.
Okay. Infrastructure, traffic. Right. And all diagrams and rules should respect the existing zones and height. For example, how can you have a 12.5 meter street wall and build an as-of-right 12 meter wall? Showing anything above the 12 meter will make existing zoning and height bylaws null and void beyond me.
Okay, so have you proposed a 12.5 meter street wall? So if you're concerned about a 12.5 meter street wall, let's just be clear. Is that what you're proposing?
West of Woodbine, it says 12.5.
Sorry, west of Woodbine, yes.
Yes, west of Woodbine, we're suggesting a 12.5 meter street wall.
So, just a second, I got it.
So that's bigger than the 12 meters that is the current as-of-right zoning. Can you explain why that's okay?
Well, what we're doing is we're proposing guidelines that vary from precinct to precinct. Right now, the zoning is 12 meters. We have not discussed changing that at all. But we can talk in the next steps about what we may do in terms of with these guidelines, whether or not we're actually looking at altering the official plan policies or changing the zoning. Certainly, one of the things that we'll have to do is to look at if the new zoning is actually suggesting 4.5 meters retail height. We think it should be lower, then that's something that we might do. But in terms of the built form that exists today west of Woodbine, we certainly see that it's very different than east of Woodbine. So east of Woodbine, it's a 9.5 meter street wall. West of Woodbine, it would be consistent with one lane square. In fact, it's actually a little lower.
Were you talking about the harmonized zoning bylaw, or are you talking about actually re-examining the zoning just of Queen Street?
Sorry.
You just need to use the mic.
Okay. Were you talking about rezoning, or the new zoning? Are you talking about the harmonized zoning bylaw, which actually leaves the height at 12 meters and density at 2x all along Queen? It'll be in place probably next year, and that has the minimum 4.5, which we want to change. Or are you saying that you are proposing that there now be another exercise where we will actually rezone Queen Street at a higher density and a higher height?
We're not proposing to rezone Queen Street. Right now we are proposing built form guidelines. We're not proposing to rezone Queen Street.
Okay. Anything else you with refinements? Yeah.
Okay. We'd like to see more detailed architectural rules to maintain the character. And I guess the bottom line is we'd like to see the study extended to incorporate all the sort of the ideas that are brought up. So we'd like to see more thought being brought into the study.
More meetings.
More meetings, maybe more feedback from not just community meetings, but if there's a way that we could kind of approach the neighborhood, whether it's some type of survey or, as you mentioned at one time, a referendum, something that you can really get the voice of what everyone's thinking.
I'm going to use that as an excuse to plug all the extra copies of the discussion guide that are there. It's a 4-pager. Maybe not everybody wants to take the book home. Take all of the extra copies with you.
The council policy and they will be the intention they be consistent with the policy of the official plan. So they will be supported by city staff. We'll be seeking with the development applications that they comply with these guidelines and making recommendations to council on that basis. If they don't comply with the guidelines, then staff would have to consider whether to recommend refusal of these applications, and this could lead to the OSB.
Great.
And should council adopt these guidelines, will be maintaining these guidelines in our recommendations to council. Again, council always makes the decision.
Thank you.
I mean, if there's a problem in the area, the developer has to show us how.
what's going on in the area, not only just not making it worse to improve on it, but if you're speaking about asking the developer to go beyond their influence, if you will, we can't demand the developer do more to improve problems in the area. I mean, if there's an existing problem in the area, it's the city's responsibility to deal with it. We can't ask the developer to go beyond his limits to make improvements area-wide, but we can make him show us how his area will not make the problem worse and as well improve it by virtue of the impact on his specific site. But we can't demand that he go beyond his site to provide improvements.
The more chance we'll have to get to everybody else.
Okay, I want to talk about the fire hall and use the fire hall to start with. And the northwest corner, people standing there at eye level will see the tower. Right now you can see the clock tower from Northern Dancer and Queen. Now, One Rainsford is going in, it has setbacks. 200 Woodbine is going to be 6 stories straight up, which is really not necessary because you're going to have Rainsford with setbacks, 200 Woodbine straight up. That property should be made to be set back so that from a distance you can still see the clock tower. It seems to have been consistent. To have one building with setbacks next to one that's straight up when obviously it would make the clock tower easier to see. But also talking about 200 Woodbine, I discovered late last night, actually this went to council on the 11th and it wasn't mentioned, and Mary Margaret didn't send out any notice of the preliminary report or anything like that having to do with it. So that preliminary report passed council. They're not going to do an avenue segment study for that building at all. So you're not getting a traffic study, an infrastructure study. A lot of the studies we're asking about here are required on an avenue if an avenue study hasn't been done. So that's not being done. The rationale for that in the study says, well, there was only one possible site west of Woodbine where you can have possible land assembly, which is incorrect because there's at least 3 at Kingston Road and 2 others. Plus, that site is right across the road from the Shell site. So the legislation talks about where it could be a precedent. Clearly, the Shell site is going to be, when they do that, they're going to point across the road at a precedent on what goes on the 200 Woodbine site. In the Licks development, they use the One Rainsford as a precedent to justify it. So we need an avenue segment study done for 200 Woodbine. And this is a... part of the problem under 9.0 asking that studies been done, because this isn't the first time, because One Rainsford there was no segment study done. We didn't get the traffic studies and all of that. On Kippendavy there were some studies done. On Licks we didn't get a traffic study of Queen Street. We didn't get an infrastructure study. We didn't get a lot of the studies that needed to be done. And this seems to be standard. On 580 Kingston Road there are lots of studies that weren't done. It seems to be very typical. This is one reason why the studies have to be done before growth is allowed, so that we have to make sure we have enough capacity on the street for more cars and longer street cars. Apart from flooding and parking and other issues, the provincial policy statement says you're not supposed to allow growth without studying that there's enough infrastructure for the planned growth. Jamie came here and was saying that they're trying to design guidelines that they can defend at the OMB. What he's therefore really indirectly indicating is that anything under these guidelines, once these guidelines are passed, they are not going to defend it, because now they've given away the game. Anything, a developer can still then go and ask for something more than the guidelines, and maybe the OMB will get it. But we know at the very minimum they can get these guidelines at the OMB, because the city is not going to fight anything less unless it's something really unusual like a heritage building or something.
I just missed it. So I get it that you think that the studies aren't happening and that they need to be happening. But you just said that you don't think the city will defend these at the OMB. I just didn't catch the last part because somebody's filming.
I'm directly saying they're not going to defend any development that is less than that. So in effect, if a developer comes in and wants to do something under this, it is going to get approved. The city is not going to fight it at the OMB, except for something like a heritage building or something really unusual that might be different. So these now become the minimum, and developers, knowing that this is the minimum, the city is not going to fight anything less, will be quite willing to ask for more. And I've seen this on Dundas West, where it's supposed to be 20 meter buildings and they're approving 25 meter buildings.
Okay,
so this
we'll
is
just get them to address okay. that. So So you have any
questions? So the current guidelines, this is worse than the current guidelines, which say three stories or the appearance of three stories, and don't say anything or indicate anything over 12 meters. We need to go back to those original guidelines and not show anything in here that shows anything above 12 meters. You can show a dotted line going off into infinity if you want, but anything in terms of actual buildings over 12 meters is opening the door and means that the planning department and city council will never defend anything.